Ham Radio Now, episode 173, the UDRX 440 and DV3000 update from the DCC in Austin, Texas. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. The UDRX 440 from NW Digital Radio is a highly anticipated radio that will run several digital modes on the 70 centimeter band. The name sums it up grandly: Universal Digital Radio. That's pretty grand. Well, I stumbled on their booth at Dayton a couple of years ago when they were just getting started. It took me a while to appreciate what this radio was all about. In his talk here at the DCC, Brian Hoyer, K7UDR, the guy that I interviewed in Dayton, will bring us up to speed on the current status of the radio. As I record this, Brian notes on their website that he is pretty comfortable with accepting orders for the UDRX this year for delivery in Q1, so I guess that'll be 2015. And in this talk, he will detail the challenges that they've had to overcome in getting this product out the door. And then Brian's partner, John Hayes, a K7VE, will talk about a product that they are shipping, the DV3000. This was designed as an add-on card to put D-Star into the UDRX 440, but he'll explain how they ended up making it work with a Raspberry Pi to create a little self-contained D-Star access device. And in the middle of the talk, Brian will take a minute to introduce the AR-ETF, the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. They're one of our corporate sponsors, and now you're going to get some background on what that's all about. Speaking of our sponsors, they are the Kickstarter backers, starting with the 108 hams who contributed between $10 and $150, all as individuals. And then there are also the big spenders, the $500 corporate underwriters, including the following:
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. But this is not another one of those ham radio podcasts. Weren't you listening just a minute ago to all that media assassination stuff? Twice a week on Sunday and Thursday, Adam and John take on the media, politicians, entertainers, anybody who's not being maybe as real as they probably ought to be. But they like ham radio, and they like ham radio now, and I'm grateful. You can listen live or by Memorex on their website. That is noagendashow.com. or using most podcast apps. And if you've listened to No Agenda, you know that Adam gets listeners to make $1,000 contributions to his show. I think there may be a lesson in there for me. We're also brought to you by Tapper. Tapper sponsors the DCC, of course. If you're interested in anything digital in ham radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you'll be at home in Tapper. If you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, please consider joining. Stop by their website, tapr.org, and check them out. We're also brought to you by several hams who encourage you to look into hackersforcharity.org. Now, you guys know that the term hacker really means people who love to dig into their computers and software and make them do cool things. Maybe a little unorthodox, but not necessarily evil. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. You might have heard of him. He figured out that he and you could use your hacking skills to help people around the world who really need you, but who certainly can't afford you. They're headquartered in Uganda. You can actually go there if you want and help them out directly, but they've got plenty of things that you can do from the comfort and convenience of your own computer desk. Maybe you'll start with just buying a t-shirt or donating some old gear. Check them out at hackersforcharity.org, and remember that Hackers for Charity didn't put up the money for this announcement. It was paid for by a group of hams who are interested in that cause. We're also brought to you by that Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. And again, Brian is going to talk about that a little bit later on in this program. I'm able to see this webpage, and you're able to watch this video because there are standards. Yeah, that's not news, especially for this audience. It's also not news that in amateur radio, standards can be a little bit hard to come by, especially in the digital and networking side of things. So Brian, K7UDR, and his buddy Kenny, KU7M, launched AR-ETF. It's patterned after the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. And a guiding principle is that you can't tell people especially hams, what to do. You've got to form a consensus, and then maybe most people will adopt a standard formed around that general agreement. They're just getting started with AREtf. If you think they may be onto something and you'd like to help, or you just want to keep an eye on what they're up to, check out the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. We're also brought to you by that enthusiastic supporter of the DCC and Ham Radio Now, who wishes to remain anonymous. I know who he is. I'm not telling, and you can't make me. The ham is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years. He is very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are able to do together, getting all these videos online for you. And finally, if you're watching these DCC programs and you weren't able to get in on the Kickstarter, it's not too late. You can still help. Stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. There you will see Arvin, our mascot. See his icon, this little thing down on the screen. And you can make a contribution. We can still use them by using a PayPal or a credit card. And my thanks to everyone who has contributed to Ham Radio Now and the Kickstarter. Now, let's get back on down to Austin and find out what these new toys are all about. Steve Bible, N7HPR, Tapper President, the introductions, please.
So I'd like to introduce the next speaker. I'd like to introduce to you Brian Hollier, K7UDR. And he is going to speak about the Universal Digital Radio, the UDRX 440 update. And then he'll speak for half the portion of the speaker slot, 20, 25 minutes, and then next up will be John Hayes, K7, Victor Echo for AMBE Serve applications, the DV3000. Take it away, Brian.
Thank you, Steve. Okay, first off, I want to thank Bruce Perrins, because I had to go back and redo all my slides at lunch because he covered a lot of things that I was going to talk about. But I think they're commonly known about issues with compatibility between radio systems. So to get me up with where you guys are, how many people have never heard of the UDR? All the people in the back who work on it, that's really encouraging. Okay. How many people have heard of it but haven't ordered it yet? Okay. How many people were so bold as to say, I want one of these? Okay, a few of you. So I'm going to kind of go through this, and we'll speed up and slow down depending on which audience we're trying to hit. So to start with, what is it? Well, it's a 25-watt, 70-centimeter software-defined radio. I was arguing with Basil earlier about what software-defined radio means. So in our particular case, it's not 100% soft, because we don't do everything in software, and the reason we don't is that's impractical at the UHF bands. So what we do is we basically build all of the protocol, all of the modulation, the demodulation, the AGC, everything about the radio is done in software, and then the remainder is done using more conventional technology. We're operating from 4800 to over 100 kilobits per second. We're gonna start with two basic protocols in modulation, AX25 using FSK, and D-Star, which uses GMSK. The fundamental radio inside is good from 100 meg to a gig. Now, there's some SAW filters in there, transmit PAs, all of that makes it band limited. But that's really no different than other SDRs, because even though someone like Flex will say it's good from DC to light, well, it doesn't make it to light because your converters run out. And if you want to transmit, you still got to hang an antenna on it, and I haven't seen an antenna yet that would go transmit from DC to light. So that's what we've got. On top of that, built into the box is an open source Linux server. Bruce talked a lot about open source. I'm a fan for a lot of the same reasons. It's very amateur radio-like. So how do we talk to it? Well, it has a network interface, so we do all the control via a web browser. Now, we are the servant of two masters here. The goal with the product is to provide something which is set it down, plug it in, easy to use for appliance operators. I hear that term used sometimes in a derogatory fashion. I don't mean it that way. Appliance operators are simply people who are more interested in operating the radio than rebuilding the radio. So we have facilities for those people, but of course, because it's a network interface, if you want to grab the keys, you can SSH into it, and do anything you would on any other Linux computer. It also has four USB accessory ports to add things like GPS or Wi-Fi or Bluetooth, weather station, storage, serial, all the common stuff that people might want to use. Let's take a look at the hardware block diagram. So when we started this project, I said something that I remind myself of occasionally. If you want to build a really good digital radio, first build a really good radio. So we focused on is doing things that are perhaps a bit overkill if you were trying to make a low-cost VHF analog-only radio. So here's our basic block diagram. On the left, you'll see the Linux single-board computer. It's not a Raspberry Pi, but it's very similar. It uses the Marvell chipset, which was first found in the Shiva plug. It's about a 1 gig processor. That talks over the spy bus to all the bunch of blocks for control. Looking at the top, we have an audio codec, and it's not just any audio codec. It's a specific one we choose because it's up to 192 kilosample rate, and it has built-in DSP filters into it. The built-in DSP filters are programmable over the spy bus, but they allow us to offload the CPU from a lot of the mundane front-end filter tasks. That goes into an IQ transceiver. It's a CML991. We make no secret of that. I believe it's the same one that Chris is using on the 991 great chip. Very high performance, provided that you put an environment around it to maintain that performance. Speaking of that, below that you'll see a DDS into a synthesizer. So the DDS is a direct digital synthesizer. It takes an input clock frequency of a 25 meg TCXO. And out of that, we build a very high granularity, sub 1 hertz, very accurate 10 megahertz sine wave. So it goes through a lot of filtering and stuff to get a very accurate, controllable 10 meg sine wave. And then we can move that relatively small amounts. That feeds into an analog device's synthesizer, where we upconvert it to approximately 740 megahertz. It's actually basically double the output frequency minus the IF frequency. So now we have the combination of extremely fine granularity and extremely low noise. The synthesizer section we've checked out, we're about minus 90, 95 dB below carrier. So it's a very pure signal. Whatever comes out of the synthesizer determines the actual quality of the RF out of the IQ transceiver, because you can't get any better going out than what goes in. Then the last block over there is just forward reverse power measuring and temperature, which is also tied back over the spy bus to put that all together. History of the project. I go to shows sometimes and people beat me up and go, when are you going to have this thing out? I've been tracking it for 4 years now. It's like, come on. We announced it in May of 2012 and said we'd deliver it end of the year. But by the end of the year, we were unhappy with the RF design, so we told everyone we're going to pull it up and start over. So we did a redesign in 2013. The processor board, the original ones, we built 25 of them. Some of them have been sitting running for literally years. So that's a solid piece. That's all behind us. We're now on our third prototype, which is in the RF lab right now. Actually, it's not in the RF lab. Actually, it's next door in the demo room. And right now, it's sitting there throwing out packets. And later, if you stop by the demo room, we'll show you a little demo of what it's doing right now. So that's where we are now. So what's next? So what's the status? The single board computer has been a workhorse. It's doing great. It needs a very light modification to add a real-time clock, which we've already tested out, and some other stuff. I talked about the DDS and synthesizer. The transceiver had some changes from the last rev to up the output power. We're now at plus 18 dBm, so we can fully saturate the PA. Let's go back a little bit to Bruce's talk about software-defined radio. One of the other things you need is almost everything else on the market, which is a TNC, is designed to go into an FM radio. But we didn't build an FM radio. We built a full SDR. So it could be an FM radio, but it could be something else. Because of that, we want the ability to saturate the PA to get that good battery performance, but we also want the ability to back off in the gate drive and run it in linear mode so we could do some fancier modulations. That allows the user to make those trade-offs of when do you want to do different things. On the receiver side, the minimum detectable signal is minus 130 dBm. I published that on the website, and I was surprised that nobody poked at me and said, I don't know how you do that. But a friend of mine who's a physicist from Caltech said, I don't think you can do that. And I said, why is that? He goes, because minus 130 is the thermal noise floor of a 50-ohm resistor in a 25K bandwidth. And I said, yeah, I didn't believe it either. So I went down to the lab where Dennis is down there hooking it up. And I said, Dennis, we have on our website a little audio file you can play, and you can step the power down, and you can still hear the tones. I said, let's recreate that. I want to see how good this is. So we did a single blind test. So we've got the HP signal generator set to 1K off the receiver, so we get a 1 kilohertz tone. And then we start stepping the power down. And I asked Dennis, I said, now just let me know with your finger, like the old ear test. I hear it, I don't, I hear it, now it's gone. Standard ear test kind of thing. So we went through that, and I could hear it. But I'm controlling the button, so that's not fair. And Dennis was 100% copy on it. So I said, how low can we go? We went down to minus 136, and then the Agilent equipment, that's its bottom floor. And we did 100% copy at minus 136. Now, here's the funny part. It's really a stupid parlor trick because there's a piece missing, and that's the fact that your head has a really good processor in it. So if you know what you're looking for, you can dig some stuff right out of the noise. But the important thing is that it's clean enough to where all the rest of the electronics running around there, the 740LO, the 500 megahertz DDR section, all those other noise sources inside the box aren't polluting the receive chain coming in. And we've checked out the baseband, ADC, and DAC in order to do those two top things. So those are all in good shape. What does that leave? Well, the next thing we're going to do is put up the RXTX switch in the output filter. We have to verify that. That's a fairly straightforward, that's a cookbook circuit. The 25-watt PA in the gate bias circuitry, a couple things going on there. The dominant thing is not whether it'll put 25 watts out. That's a no-brainer. The big question is, once again, how much of that gets in and interferes with other things. So we have to go check out some stuff there. There may be some shielding changes there. The gate bias circuitry, I mentioned that earlier. Most FM radios are high, medium, low, and they just do it by modulating the input. They leave the gate bias at saturation all the time. We actually have a D to A converter which goes into a switch, so you can both set the bias and then still do a transmit-receive very fast. So that has to get checked out. We've done everything with a 25 kilohertz IF. There's a second path for 100 kilohertz IF. We had some difficulties in getting the SAW parts you wanted, so we had to do a two-stage filter. Half of it in SAW filters in the IF, and the other half in the audio section. That's left to be checked out. Thermal management rides along with the 25-watt PA. Once you light the amp up, you need to make sure that everything's under control. We actually have a second little tiny Atmel processor that's on the RF deck just for these kinds of functions. And the reason for that is partly because I don't trust big processors and operating systems with small tasks which are very important in real time. And also, a lot of you want to play with it. Anybody ever have code that crashes? Well, if your code crashes and you leave the PA on, then you're going to smoke the thing. So that's just my own view of the world to do those things in a small processor. So that's what takes care of that. So how about software? Well, the good news is the later your hardware team is, the more your software team gets to catch up. So the software guys, they're always behind, but then I have some problem and they catch up again. So they're actually at the point where they're pretty well caught up. AX25 stack is all in place. Question, how many folks think the AX25 stack is buggy? This rumor keeps going around. People say to me, well, we don't use that because it's buggy. We found zero problems with it. Now, we found problems in TNCs connected to it, but we've never found any problems with the AX25 stack itself, which doesn't mean you have to use it. If you want to rewrite it all and use LinBPQ or whatever your favorite thing is, JNOS, you're free to go change it. But architecturally, the AF25 stack is a very convenient way to do it because it feeds directly into the thing below it, which is the socket interface. So the major blocks of software, which are performing the different functions, all use socket interfaces. And there's a few reasons for this. The biggest one is it's a straightforward way to connect streams together, and it's well documented and defined. But the other reason is by doing it this way, it is possible to talk into the end of the radio from a different computer. Which means if you wanted to do something like Codec 2, we played around with a while for, well, how do we get Codec 2 converted to fixed point to run in our box? And the answer is, you don't. You just leave it on some other box. And then the output, which is a very tiny stream, because Codec 2's whole purpose in life is to make small streams into tiny streams. And the tiny streams go over the wire, and they go into the IQ modulator, and you're done. There is one step in between. It's called a Hilbert transform. It's about that much code. You get it off the web. So that's how we're going to deal with things like that. Another thing that came out of this was I've been keeping a really strong eye on what's happening with IPv6. And we went to a recent seminar, and somebody popped up and said, why do you keep shoving this new technology on us? And the guy said, well, think of it this way. IPv4 is 40 years old, and IPv6 is 20 years old, so we figured it's about time you start looking at it. But it caught my interest. At first, I thought, well, the last thing I need is a bigger header. When I started looking at IPv6, we have a thing called header compression, which allows you to connect using a great big long header routable anywhere in the world, and then switch to a single byte header within your local group. That's very efficient. There's also examples, that one came out of UC California, Berkeley, of people running IPv6 stacks for small sensor networks using an MPS 430 processor. That's a 10 megahertz PIC class processor. So clearly it's not a heavyweight thing. Other things it does is it deals with streaming protocols. And one of the things that we're facing is, I'm always amazed at how people in different industries don't look at what other industries do. They reinvent the wheel. So a long, long time ago, when they invented the telephone, they had to go through this migration of telephone analog to digital, and they developed specific protocols for that. The network world uses completely different protocols. Clocking's different, the packetization's different. And then about 20 years ago, they started the great netcom-telecom merge. Well, that means we're about 20 years behind because all of our radio stuff is digital voice based with a few bits triggering along the back instead of building it into a network and just putting voice over it. So, but we're going that direction, there's no doubt about it. IPv6 solves a lot of problems that hams will hack away at to try to solve within their own protocols. When if we just move forward, it'll become a lot easier. What else is going on? So the FSK modulator, that's the actual DSP code. Basil doesn't write that, Dennis does. It's not very big, but it's very important. The modulator section is done. Changing baud rates and stuff for that is relatively straightforward. It's recompile and test. The DMOD is still under development because we're doing something different here. Your standard DMOD is what's called a non-coherent demodulator, meaning that your receiver has no notion of the actual inbound carrier frequency. We've done that, but we're also building a fully coherent demodulator because it has some gains in what's called EBN-naught. So fundamentally, for any rate and noise floor, you get a theoretical curve to how good your performance can be. And then your test as building a product is, well, how close do you get to that? So most ham radios are 3 to 6 dB off from the theoretical ones. Commercial gear gets to under 2. They have a dollar incentive to get as much as they can out of the bandwidth. We're trying to bring that number down. And to do that, we're going to need coherent demodulation. So that's under development. The MB3000 interface, this is an interesting one. So when we first planned this in 2012, a lot of people were interested in doing D-Star. And you can do the D-Star protocol without having the AMBI chip if you're just building a gateway. Digital in, digital out, we get them, we shove them through, we don't care. Some people want to actually do the voice encode, decode on our radio. And to do that, you need an AMBI chip. Originally, we used the 2000 chip, which Bruce showed on a little slide up there. Yeah, it's a $20-something dollar chip. And we put it on a separate board instead of integrating it because, one, a lot of people don't need it. And the other one was I was trying to make a point about economics. This is just a relatively modest piece of software. And someday, you won't buy an extra piece of hardware to do this. You'll just put it in along with the rest of the stuff. That day was a long way away 10 years ago. It's getting closer to where that's a reality. We're going to see a lot more activity there. So in the development, I had a proprietary header on our CPU board to get the few pins involved. There's a UART, a couple other pins involved to make the whole thing work. And in a recent rev, actually in prototype 2, I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, you know, if I put this on a Pi header, then I could ship it to my development guys and at least they could start writing software for it. And then John Hayes said, well, if you put it in a Pi, you know, people would buy those. And I said, you've got to be kidding me. I don't know why anybody would buy an AMBI card on the Pi board. But I just did it for the engineering stuff. So this May at Hamvention, we brought 100 of them, and John lost the bet. He said he'd sell all 100 at Hamvention, and it took two more days to sell them all out. So he still owed me for that one. But since that time, they've been rolling out. We're now in 5 continents, and Singapore just popped in, so 27 countries. But exceedingly popular internationally. I don't quite understand that. I'm not quite sure how to get into Antarctica, but John's got a program for that. And Africa, I guess that'll happen someday. So it's going to be in a lot of different places. And John's going to tell you all about what people are doing with it. It's also a great example of open source software because we didn't write any of the software for the DV3000. Jonathan Naylor in the UK, he's got his dummy repeater. And we sent him a board and he ported his stuff over to it. So it's a great example of how amateur radio works together to do things that otherwise no commercial entity could afford to do or the advantage is high enough to do, and yet it's got value to people. What about the user interface? Well, the user interface is based on web sockets, which any modern browser has. The control and status is into place. We have an APRS client. We have ported we means Basil. APRX iGate, WebSocket means Audrey. He's got that running. We took Dan Smith's Dan Tracker and ported that and made some changes to it to make it more socket friendly. And now we have a tracker thing in there. That does require a GPS, but we have a USB port, so you just plug one in and you're done there. The WinLink client is there. The RMS gateway's there. And the WinLink client is interesting. We didn't reinvent the mail client because that's been done. So we just implement IMAP or POP3, and then you configure Thunderbird or Apple Mail or whatever you want to use to be your mail client. And then WinLink is just one more thing in the box. You can also use, actually on the radio, something like NeoMail or SquirrelMail. And that's kind of interesting for people in MCOM because MCOM, you want the mail to go to the MCOM address, not necessarily to your personal box. So that means you've got a box sitting someplace anybody can walk up to, browse into, and get the current context of what's going on. So that looks pretty interesting. Here's a picture of the interface. The way this is organized is we try to make it as much like a traditional radio. So above the red bar is the control head. And it's got everything there that you expect, frequency, power, duplex or not, those kinds of things, some routing information. You log into it with your call sign, it remembers that. That's the source. And then the destination is according to the channels, which are over on the channel menu. And for every channel, you get to do some configuration. You get to name it. There's no limit to how many channels you have. You can export it as a CVS. You can give it to your friends. We're going to pre-stuff it, though, with some special channels, which I'll talk about later in another planet. Navigation down the side, status across the bottom. This runs on a netbook or a PC or a Mac or an iPhone or an iPad or anything which has a modern browser. By modern, I mean one that supports WebSockets, which means you can run it on Windows XP if you use Chrome or Firefox, but if you're absolutely stuck on I must use Internet Explorer 8, then you won't be able to use this interface. But if you're really stuck on Internet Explorer 8, you have other issues to deal with. That's correct. It's not that we're not supporting it, it's that Microsoft intentionally didn't support it to move you to Windows 7 or 8. So that's a marketing move on their part, which is why if you really want to stick with XP, you can run Chrome or Firefox and it still works. So what's it all mean? Everyone says to me, so we're going to get it. Well, let's look at what we have to, left to do. We got to finish the Proto 3 bring up. Now, I think that Proto 3 will be our last prototype, but I'm not sure of that. If we do have to do another proto spin, one of the goals when you spin boards is don't break the stuff that works. So if we do have to do a spin, it'll just be in the PA section, the filter. We may have to do a little things there because it's not the kind of stuff you want to prototype with the wires hanging around at 440 megahertz. At the point where we have that checked out, and I've got full power transceivers, functional, we'll then accept the initial orders from all of you who pre-order with a discount and some more folks past that. At that point, we're going to do a pilot run. Now, pilot runs are everything is full manufacturing, but before you pull a trigger and say, give me 1,000 of something that I might stack in a dumpster, you say, give me 20 of them, and I'll stack those in a dumpster if something goes wrong. But you've got all the parts. See, the main thing is to get the part flow going, because a lot of these parts are long lead time. So you've got to get high volume orders in place, and you do a test run of 20 boards. Those 20 units will go to people we've identified who have interesting software solutions they want to develop on this box. Because obviously it's in our best interest to get the software developers funded. And then once we're happy with those, I have the opportunity for a quick touch-up, and it goes full manufacturing. Manufacturing is done. Boards, parts, assembly, and board test happens in China, in Shenzhen province. Actually, it's Shenzhen City in Guangdong province. And then that's all shipped to the U.S. Final assembly, PA integration, and test is all done in the U.S. So we can be like Apple and say, designed in Cupertino, designed on San Juan Island, and assembled and tested in the USA. Some folks have said to me, well, why don't you build them in the USA? I'd pay the few dollars more. Who would pay $200 more? The problem is it's not just a few dollars. And a lot of it is supply chain issues. Radios have large numbers of passive components. If you look at the end connector on our board, in the US I pay $14 for it. I pay 50 cents in China. So yeah, I could buy connectors here, or I could buy Chinese connectors and bring them over here and have them assembled here. The supply chain issues, it doesn't make sense. A good friend of mine is a retired executive from one of those three big radio companies. And when he learned about this, he said to me, where are you going to make it? And I said, China. He said, good. He said, because if you don't build it there, somebody else will. So it's partly a defensive strategy on our part to make sure we give you the best product at the best price, and we stay in business long enough to make the whole thing work out. Okay. In the words of Monty Python, and now for something completely different. Hi. I'm not Brian. I'm no longer associated with Northwest Digital Radio, but I got something I want to talk about because it's been bugging me. Let's talk about the internet. I'm going to move real fast. Internet, the inner network of computers. Every computer on the internet can talk to every other computer using standard protocols and addressing schemes. You really believe that Cisco and Juniper and, well, hell, they weren't even around when the internet was invented. Bay Networks and the rest of those folks, you think they all got together and did what the radio community is doing? Everybody creates their own fiefdom, as Bruce calls them. They all go by standards. Who sets the standards? Anybody? Not you. Who?
IETF.
What is the IETF?
Internet Engineering Task Force.
Bingo. The IETF sets all the standards. What is it? It's not a club or entity. There's no dues or membership. There's no corporate sponsorship. It has no authority. I love that one. A standards body that has no authority.
No membership list.
Kenny was on the, when he was at Microsoft, he was on the Universal Plug and Play Standards Committee. He knows about these things. They have no authority. Maybe that's why it works. Because when you have authority, you can just tell people, this is how we're going to do it. But if you don't, you have to go, I think this is how we'd like to do it. What do you think? You got to learn to get along. It's organized by working groups. The origination of a working group. It's called the BOF, Birds of a Feather. And it operates on, I love this, rough consensus. Let's try to figure out what we can agree upon and not argue about the stuff we don't agree upon. What's the goal? What's that?
Have you ever been to an IETF meeting?
Only by video.
Okay, I was just going to say about that last point.
Yes, I know. But, well, let's stick at the ideal, right? And not dive into the details. So I decided I would form the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. You're all in it. Okay? You have an amateur ticket. You're part of it. We want us to become the place to further the development, testing, and dissemination of amateur radio standards. Did all you get input on the YAESU Fusion standard? Of course not. Did all of you read the JARL version 5 D-Star standard? Oh wait, it's in Japanese. Here's some examples of working groups that I'm working on right now. A couple years ago, I talked about authentication at a meeting, and then later someone did something about it, and then HESU talked about it, and earlier this year, Andrew Pavlin of YAC implemented it. We all need to do authentication in a similar way using standards. Phil Karn is interested in high-speed modems. Brian Heaton, who does HSMM West Coast, is looking at mesh networking. And you figure out what the other groups should be. Interested? It's a skeletal website. It's just a place for us to talk about it. But I want to get the discussion going. John?
We'll make this as quick and painless as possible. As Brian said, we created the DV3000. It's an AMBI 3000 chip, which is the newer chip. It will plug and play with the UDRX. It'll plug and play with the Raspberry Pi. We've distributed a lot of these so far. I've taken like 3 support calls. So either people aren't making them work, I know they are making them work, or they're pretty easy to get going. It is the D-Star vocoder. As Brian mentioned, Jonathan ported his stuff for us. This chip is easier to talk to than the 2020, which was the original D-Star chip. It is the vocoder for D-Star. It also can do the vocoder for DMR, DPMR, P25 phase 2, half rate, fusion half rate, and full rate. So if you want to monitor or play with any of those, you can have a licensed piece of software to do that. Okay, so to install a DV3000, we have one in the demo area. You can see it. You install the current Raspbian on your Raspberry Pi. You modify 3 files to free up the UART port so it'll talk to the DV3000 at 230 kilobits. You power down and install the board. You reboot. You run a little Python test program to make sure that it's talking to your Raspberry Pi. That takes about 30 seconds. You download and compile and start a little daemon. And if you have a smartphone and you take that QR code, you can go and read this in detail or the URL. So there are 3 major things going on right now. There's something called AMBI tools. It basically converts WAV files to and from .dvtool and .ambi, which are the 2 that are used by a lot of programs in the D-Star world. The code is on the IRCDB gateway forum on Yahoo. And again, I gave you a QR code. Okay, this is the one that I've played with the most. It's dummy repeater. Basically, dummy repeater talks to the D-Star network like it was an actual on-the-air repeater, but instead it has an audio in, audio out, and PTT capability. So you can set up a microphone, a speaker, and pretend you're talking through a repeater, and it talks to the rest of the network just like you were a repeater. And some people have actually taken that and wired it to an analog radio, so you have an analog to D-Star gateway. And there's a good video of that by Michael from down in Australia, you can get that off of our site as well. If you're going to run Dummy Repeater on the Pi itself, Jonathan's software uses the port audio library because it runs both on Windows and on Linux. The ALSA version of it was done by G8BPQ, runs a little better there, so you want to go ahead and get that. Architecturally, it's really simple. The DV3000D runs as a daemon on the board on the Pi. It sits at a known UDP port. You can access it locally on your LAN. You can access it over the local interface on the Pi itself, the 127.001. You can access it on a LAN. You can access it over the internet. I've done that. The dummy repeater talks to it over that port. Then dummy repeater talks out to an audio interface. And then that talks to IRC DDB gateway, which talks to the rest of the DSTAR network over the internet. So JA1SCW was one of the early orders of this part. That's a Pi. The red board is the DV3000. He put a microphone and a speaker in the same case. He has Wi-Fi in it, and he walks around his neighborhood and uses it as his portable radio. He uses one of the GPIO pins for push-to-talk. And that's the basic diagram of what he did. And then the other thing that's being actively worked on right now is a fellow named Mike Zingman, and you can use that QR code to go find the exact article where he talks about it. Took the DSD program, which is open source software that handles the protocol layer, but it either uses the MBE library that Bruce was talking about to do the decoding and encoding, or what Mike has done is strip that MBE library out and put the DV3000 in, so you have a hardware solution for that that is legally licensed. And he'll be publishing that pretty soon. Right now it works for DSTAR DMR. He's working on P25. And he hasn't quite published it yet, but we're hoping that'll come out soon. So this is the board. We sell it for $99. We brought a few along. If you're over in the demo area, we'll sell you one for a little less. We'll pick up the tax. There's no shipping. Or you can order it online at our website. Thank you.